car to start praying every morning and every night for that particular problem.
After Chaplain Yetna and Kamho spent weeks praying for her heart issue, the doctors were surprised at what they saw.
I was praying that maybe the fifth time that I went, he said that the doctor was surprised that what happened, I'm not seeing the disease more.
And the doctor called the parent in the office, in the laboratory, to ask them what they gave her. And they told the doctor nothing.
The heart issue had vanished, and the only medicine given was prayer.
Now he has made me to learn that God is the first thing that we should think in life. It's all. So now that he has told me this, I've started praying with him every day.
The Adventist Church in Cameroon is concentrated in the southern part of the country. Church leaders want to impact lives like Kamho's in the northern region of the country as well. Currently, there are no Adventist schools in that area, making it a tremendous mission opportunity.
It is very important to build a school in the northern region where there are many non-Adventists and even many non-Christians. It is very important, firstly, for the mission, because as you know, we have to reach the regions that may not have heard about Christ.
There is already a plot of land dedicated to the new school building. They have blueprints and a vision of what the school will look like once finished. This 13th Sabbath offering will go to help the church in Cameroon build their first school in the northern region. Please pray for this project, which will provide an opportunity to spread the gospel to unreached people. Thank you for your support of the 13th Sabbath offering.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Welcome to the last Sabbath of the year. This year has passed really fast, and so will be until Jesus comes. Let's start the worship service with hymn 487, In the Garden.
And the voice.
our next hymn, let's pass close by to number 462, Blessed Assurance.
Come to the last Sabbath of this year, that Lord, you would show us the need that we have, that we might not even understand that we have, to be rooted and grounded in your love. Lord, you said that they will know you're my disciples by your love. And so Lord, we're asking, Father, that you would do a special work in our hearts today, because the love that you have for us, Lord, it is impossible for us to communicate that in words, or it has to be in action. And so we're asking you, Father, that we would become your habitation. We would become your temples, that, Lord, you would use us to touch hearts and change lives. And so we invite your spirit. We acknowledge your presence, Father. And we ask you to do for us that which we cannot do for ourselves. Lord, you said, can the Ethiopian change his skin? Can you who are in the habit of doing evil do good? But Lord, when we abide in you and your word abides in us, Lord, you said we will bear much fruit. So we thank you, Father. We love you. In Jesus' name, let everybody say, amen. You may be seated. Good morning, everyone. Better than that. Good morning, everyone. Feliz Sábado. Anso konichi omedetto. That's Japanese. See, I got you. So we want to welcome you all to the Clairemont Seventh-day Adventist Church. And I am the pastor, Pastor London Lee. And it is a blessing to be here with you. And we're going to go through our announcement. Today is the day that the Lord has made. So we want to welcome you and say happy Sabbath. Everybody say happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. And so if you are a visitor or if you have a prayer request, we want to invite you, if you have your smartphone, take out your smartphone and you can scan this and we have a gift for you, either in English or in Spanish. And if you want to send your prayer request, the prayer request come to me, and then on Wednesday night, we pray for your prayer requests and your praises, your thanksgivings, all of that. So also, I'm going to talk about this a little bit later, but on January 1st, if you open your bulletin, you should have a flyer, and it should say the 7-Day Media Detox Challenge. And so what we are challenging ourselves is, oftentimes, at the beginning of the year, we want to detox the body, but in 2024, we need to detox the mind. So I'll give you more information about that later. And so also, we have our Pathfinders, and they're going where? Where are they trying to get to? Gillette, Wyoming, and that's just down the street, right? No, and we have over 30 people who are going to Gillette. This is the international camporee, and guess what? People are going to be from every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. And I don't know if you know it, these camporees, young people give their lives to Jesus in a special way. And so we want to invite you to partner with us as we want to send all of our Pathfinders to Gillette. Outside in the foyer, you'll see the thermometer and how much we have raised. Can I get an amen? And then you'll see how much more we need. So pray about it. If God impresses it on your heart to give, give and give liberally. Amen. Also, we are going to be resuming our Wednesday night prayer meetings. What are we going to be doing? We're going to resume our Wednesday night prayer meeting. That will be this Wednesday at 6:30. We meet. We come and we take prayer requests and we sing songs and then we have a short study and then we pray. So this year we've been studying prayer. We spent all year and our topic was prayer. And so next year, next week, we have a new exciting topic. And guess what? How will you know what topic we'll be studying? You will have to come. Now, if you cannot come in person, you can actually Zoom in. The number is in the bulletin, so please take advantage of that. Also, this Thursday, we will have our first board meeting of the year. That will be at 6:30 p.m. If you are a new board member, you're going to meet here in person. And if you're an old board member, then you're going to Zoom in so that we can all be there together. And so also, January 20th will be the 41st year anniversary of San Diego Clairemont. Did you guys know that? And so we're going to have a special service. We're going to have a special guest speaker who was actually a pastor of this church many, many, many years ago. And we're going to tell the story of Clairemont. And so we want to invite you to come and be a part of that special service. And so we just want to welcome you again, and we pray that you would be blessed and that you would be so blessed that when you leave here, you would be a blessing to many, many people. Can I get an amen? Amen. Welcome.
Morning, church family, and happy Sabbath. Last week, the secretary of the nominating committee, that's Brother Orlando Aguilar. He read the names that were selected by the church to hold offices in the church. And so today he will continue with that. Today we'll do the voting. So here's Brother Orlando.
Thank you, Brother Tony. I am going to this time read only the leads because last week we read all the names. And after that we will do the vote. For the elders, the Department of Elders, the lead is going to be Brother Jose Deschamps. For the Department of Deacons, the leader is going to be Brother Emmanuel Irizarry. For the Department of Deaconesses, Brother Mayla Yassin. If you want to see all the names, they are in your bulletin. For the Department of the Prayer Coordinators, this is going to be led by the head elder. For the Department of Health and Temperance, Sister Stacy Rivera will be leading this department. For the Department of Safety Officer, Brother Ryan Spring will be leading this department. For the Department of the Treasurer, Brother David will be leading this department. For the Church Clerk, Sister Rina will be leading. For the Department of the Board Secretary, Sister Patty Beck. For the Department of Communications Secretary, Brother Jonathan Lopez. For the Department of Personal Ministries, Sister Christine Nguyen. And a name was removed from here. Sister Tracy, she wanted to remove her name from this department. For the Department of Religious Liberty, Brother Elder Tony Felix will be leading this department. For the Department of the Music Committee, Sister Fabi will be leading this department. For the Department of BPS Leader, Sister Jennifer Navarro will be leading this department. For the Department of Pathfinders, Brother Jonathan will be leading this department. For the Department of Family Ministries, Sister Chorquindes Champs will be leading this department. For the Department of Audio and Video, Brother Sam Anguiano will be leading this department. For the Department of Building Project Manager, Brother David Seca will be leading this department. For the Department of Saval School Secretary, Brother Cave will be leading this department. For Children's Ministry Coordinator, we have Sister Angie Urueta leading this department. For the Department of Cradle Role, Sister Jennifer Navarro will be leading this department. For the Department of Kindergarten Sabbath School, Sister Angie Urueta will be leading this department. For Primary Sabbath School, Sister Diane McCutcheon will be leading this department. For Junior Sabbath School, Brother Ron Seca will be leading this department. For Youth Sabbath School, Brother Ryan will be leading this department. For the Department of Young Adult Leader, Brother Vincent will be leading this department. For the Department of AY, Sister Nikisha Lee will be leading this department. For the Department of the Church Website and Social Media Operator, Brother Elijah Fuentes will be leading this department. For the Department of the Greeters, the Head Deacons and Head Deaconesses will be leading that department. And finally, during this week, we added another ministry, the Women's Ministry, which will have a representation on the board by the Sister Perla Sanchez and will be co-lead by Sister Perla Sanchez, Sister Tracy Hall, and Sister Molina Moyo. These are all the names of the leaders for the next year, the directors.
Last Sabbath, after the names were read to the church, there were no comments, there were no objections to the names. So at this time, you heard Brother Orlando call the leaders, but they will be working. There's a rotation within each department, each section. So don't feel like, you know, somebody's just, you have one person presiding over an office. And so if at this time we have no comments, objections to the names, so we'd like to enter a motion to vote in the names for the new offices. If there's anyone who'd like to, okay, we have a second. So, amen, thank you. So all in favor of accepting the names that were read or that's listed in the insert of the bulletin as officers for the new year, please say amen. Any refrain, any objections? So it's carried that those names that were read or listed in the insert, they will be the officers leading, you know, those departments for the church. It's a very serious commitment. And so if you feel, well, you still have maybe time or maybe the energy or the Spirit has impressed upon you that you would like to still serve in some capacity, please see one of the elders or even the pastor, because the church is always looking for workers. Amen? And as I close, I'd like to just take the time to thank the pastor who chaired the nominating committee and also the secretary, Brother Orlando Aguilar, who did a fantastic job of coordinating those meetings, making sure that they stay on track, contacting the candidates. And so here we are. It's a new year. We are closing out the old year, and we are looking forward to a new year. And it's a time that we have to take stock of ourselves. Let's do a self-audit. See where we were cold, where we will look warm. And, you know, we're looking forward to a new year, and so we must be revived. We must be rejuvenated. And so this let's remember those offices in your prayers. Amen? Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Let's stand up for the opening hymn 331, O Jesus, I Have Promised.
The presence of the world, of the Lord.
those who are able, let's kneel. Oh, gracious and heavenly Father. Oh, Father, we want to thank you for being the God that you are. Father, you said that there is none like you. And to that we say amen and amen and amen. Oh, Father, you've brought us safely through this week. You've provided, you've cared for us, you've sheltered us. You made your word available to your children, Father. But above all, Father, you've carried us through the end of the year, caring, providing, hearing our prayers, hearing our petitions, our praises. Oh, Father, we want to thank you. Thank you. Thank you for this great blessing you've bestowed upon your children. But, Father, there's even a greater blessing in giving your Son to us because you realize our condition. And we, as a people, we need to realize our condition before we can come to you, dear God. Oh, Father, so as we're here, we gathered, some of them have gathered around the rostrum. You know where we are in our hearts, dear God, where we are lacking, where we are cold, where we are lukewarm, where we are negligent, oh, Father, and in some areas maybe even absent. But, Father, we can come to you knowing that you will hear our petitions. We'll bring it all to you and lay it all on the altar, and you will attend to it. Oh, Father, give us hearts that are willing, hearts that are tuned towards the things that are righteous. Father, this is the last Sabbath of the year 2023, and we want to just thank you, give you the praise, give you the glory. But, Father, as we look to the new year, oh, Father, we want to go into the new year revived. Father, we want to go, oh, you leading the way and allowing us to follow. Father, we ask your special blessing upon us. Meet us at the point of our need, dear God. Father, we see the things that are happening, the signs, the waymarks, and we need to be a people that are alert. You ask us to watch and pray. Watch and pray, Father. And not only watch, but we need to tell others. We need to show others, oftentimes not by just preaching, but, Father, by the way we live, or we walk with you. It has to be grounded in truth, grounded in righteousness, because that's what we're called to do. Father, I ask that you put your laws in our mind and write it on our hearts that we might not sin against you, dear Father. The sins that beset us, dear God, we ask you to take them away. Father, we learn from 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 14, that if my people who are called by my name, for we are created to be your people, dear God, nothing else, to see anything else is to reject it. My people who are called by my name shall humble themselves. Oh, give us humble spirits, contrite hearts, dear God, that you may begin that goodly work in your children. Seek your face for prayer and study, diligent study of your word, dear Father. Turn away from our evil ways, oh Father, help us, lead us all to repentance. Lead us all to repentance and put your spirit in us afresh, dear God. Father, we are 1 year closer towards your second coming. And Father, we must be a people who are ready, not only for your second coming, but the times that are coming, Father. Perilous times, troublous times, but we must be deeply rooted that we may be able to stand. So be with your children, dear God, oh Father. Allow the Spirit to speak to our hearts, our consciences, oh Father, quicken it. Bless our families, our children. Bless this church, bless the work of evangelism. Not only at this church, but everywhere, Father, where your people are working diligently to bring souls into the kingdom. Oh, Father, whatever it is that is, whatever stumbling blocks, whatever it is that's holding us back from making decisions, dear God, open our spiritual eyes, Father. Help us to buy gold that is refined in the fire, that our faith may grow, our trust, our hope, all in the person of Jesus. Father, we give the sick, we give those who are looking for work, we give those who are going through health challenges, relational, in the home, in the church, on the job, in the neighborhood, Oh, Father, we give it all to you. And Father, as we surrender, we ask you to teach us, mold us, shape us into the person that we are to be, that we may reflect always the character of Christ, not only in speech, but in action. And so, Father, as I close, I want to thank you. May your blessings be upon our speaker as he brings the word. Oh, Father, our hearts are calloused. The things that we invite into our hearts, into our minds, they prevent the word from entrenching, growing deep roots into our heart soil. And so I pray, dear Father, declutter us. Take off those things as we go into the new year, dear Father, that your word, oh, may take root, and we may produce the fruits of the fruit of the Spirit, as we read in Galatians chapter 5, dear Father. Be with the pastor, be with him, his family, the board of, we just presented the new officers for the church. Oh, Father, help them to seek your face. Send your Holy Spirit upon them, Father, that this church may do your will within this community. And as I close, I want to thank you for hearing our prayers. Thank you for guiding us, for leading us, for seeking, for making yourself available to us whenever, wherever. And we thank you for hearing our prayers again, for we ask it all in the wonderful name of Jesus, who is our Lord, our Savior and Redeemer. Amen. Take your seats.
Happy Sabbath. Today's worship and giving is going to the union designated. So I'll be reading from 1 John 2, verse 15 to 17. Or the verses are, do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, love for the Father is not in them. For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away. So as Christians, we believe that the world is passing away, and that the pride of life begins to loosen its grip unto us when we place God first. By returning our tithes and offerings, our offerings today is for our local union conference. So let us support the Lord's vineyard in our local field. May the deacons stand up for the word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, that you have brought each one of us, each one of the brothers and sisters here at your house. Bless each one of them that gives the tithes and offerings, and multiply it that it may be used in your field, in your vineyard, to grow the church and to grow your ministry, reaching all parts around the world to further your message and your soon coming, Lord. Thank you for everything. In your name I pray, amen.
Continue with our worship and giving as we take up the Lamb's offering. So we'll ask all the children, and we have tons of them here at Clairemont. Praise the Lord for that. They'll go to the back of the sanctuary where we have baskets. And after they've taken out the offering, they will gather next to the piano.
Good morning, boys and girls. Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Okay. Have you ever read the story Horton Hatches the Egg by Dr. Seuss? No? It's a wonderful story about an elephant named Horton. So we'll pretend this is Horton. This is what Horton looks like. Can you guys see? Yeah? From the Grinch. Okay. It's a wonderful story about an elephant named Horton. The story begins with a lazy bird named Maisie. So Maisie sitting on her egg in a tree. Sitting on the egg was tiresome and boring, and Maisie hated it. She said, "I'd take a vacation, fly off for a rest if I could, find someone to stay on my nest." That's when Horton walked by. Maisie asked Horton if he would sit on her egg while she took a little rest. Horton objected at first, but Maisie promised that she would not be gone long. So Horton finally agreed, and soon he was sitting on the nest while Maisie flew off to Florida for a vacation. That's nice. In Florida, Maisie had such fun that she decided she would never return to her nest. Days turned into weeks, and weeks turned into months. But Horton kept sitting there day after day. Winter came, and icicles hung from Horton's trunk and his feet, but still, he remained faithful to his promise to Maisie. This is what Horton looks like during the winter time. You see? Yeah, he looks so cold and wet, but he stayed there because he made a promise. So he said, I'll stay on this egg and I won't let it freeze. I meant what I said and I said what I meant. An elephant is faithful 100%. Now, I don't know if elephants are really faithful 100% or not, but I know someone who is. God is faithful 100%. The Bible is full of the promises of God, and God is always faithful to keep his promises. In the Bible, there's a story about a man named Simeon. Simeon was a very old man who had faithfully served God all of his life. Simeon was looking forward to the coming of the Messiah. God had promised Simeon that he would not die until he had seen the Christ, the promised Messiah. A few days after the birth of Jesus, Mary and Joseph took Jesus to the temple to dedicate him to God. Simeon was in the temple. As soon as Simeon saw the baby, he knew that Jesus was the Christ and that God had kept his promise that he would not die until he had seen the Messiah. God is faithful to his promises 100%. We are at the beginning of a new year. Many of us will make promises to God about things that we will do in the new year. Do you guys have any New Year's resolution? Yeah? Would you like to share yours? You forgot? It's okay. So, I'm afraid that many times there are promises made but never kept. If God is faithful to keep his promises to us, don't you think that it is important for us to keep our promises to him? This year, as we make our promises to God, let us say, like Horton, I meant what I said, and I said what I meant. I'll be faithful to God 100%. Anyone wants to pray? Mateo, do you want to pray? No? Okay, I'll pray. Let's close our eyes, bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for being so faithful to us every day of our lives. Please help us to be faithful as well, just like you are. All these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. Please stand for the reading of the Word of God. I pray that the Lord may bless the reading of His Word. We're going to read in Ephesians. I didn't bring the bulletin. Is it 3:17? Okay, thank you. That Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. That ye, being rooted and grounded in love. Amen. You may be seated.
to be here. I was here a few years ago. My membership is here. And it's wonderful to see familiar faces, friends and family, and new faces too. The church has only gotten more beautiful. See the beautiful kids here. It's a blessing. So I had a wonderful year this year, but as we all know, there's been a lot of troubling things going on in the world. And I look forward to when Jesus returns, because when he comes, that all tears will be wiped off all faces. When he comes, death shall be swallowed up in victory, and there shall be no more sickness, no more sorrow, no more death. What a rich promise we have. Pray that we keep God's commandments and that we may have the right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. Can you hear me okay?
shout of his coming, and the sleeping shall rise. Their slumbering place, and those who remain shall be changed in a moment, and we shall behold him then face to face.
Our greatest hope is to behold you. And Lord, we can behold you day by day, moment by moment, not only in your word, but in the people you came to save. Lord, we pray that you would speak to us now. In Jesus' name we pray. Can everyone say? Amen. Can you believe that this is the last Sabbath of the year? That means this is number 52, and God has been faithful every single week. Can I get an amen? And so we just want to say thanks to God for his faithfulness. And so this year, actually a year and a half since my family and I came here, we've been talking about this thing called what? Evangeliving. And we spent a lot of time together. We spent a lot of time teaching and spent a lot of time preaching. But if you remember, in the cycle of evangeliving, after we do the preparation, after we do the planting, after we do the harvest, then what will preserve that experience? You know, ever had that mountaintop experience with God, and then you come down into the valley, and the gloom and the realities of life are are sometimes able to steal that joy you had in the mountaintop. Remember Moses? Moses spent 40 days and 40 nights in the presence of God, and he came down, and God's people were acting a fool, as they say. And Moses lost his experience. And so I believe that God has a heart, and his heart is set upon people. But his heart goes out to the worst of the worst of the worst. The people that we throw away, the people that we overlook, those are the people. So the worst off a person is, in God's eyes, his heart goes out even more to that person. And so, just a few months ago, I think it was 8 months ago, we had a meeting here at this church, and God has given us an opportunity to go out and to bring service and love together. So after we have learned, after we have studied, after we have prepared, guess what? There needs to be action. And so I told you a few weeks ago that we were challenged about, we have the trailer for showers, but what don't we have? We don't have a truck. So we need about $60,000 or $70,000 more dollars to get this truck. And someone, Brother Abraham, challenged me to get out into the streets. And this is Brother Abraham. This was last, on Christmas Day, we were supposed to only spend 4 hours, but we actually spent 12 hours making a special meal, because as we have been going out, we have been coming in contact with many people, specifically from Venezuela. So if you're from Venezuela, raise your hand. Ah, there we go. And so we have been going out ministering. And so there's this special meal. They are, just slipped my mind, tamales, there we go. But they're called hallacas, right? Hallacas. And so we learned how to make hallacas. And we spent not 4 hours, but we spent 12 hours making this special meal so that we could go out, because there's one block on Commerce Street and there are literally Venezuelan families living on the street. So this is us learning. And then this is us when we went out. This was the day after Christmas, and we actually went out into, and we had this special meal. So we took the soup that we take every week, and we told the people, hey, we vamos a comer, right? Like, come on, let's come over here and eat. And you see some of the people are shy, but we had fun in service. And so we went out, this little boy came up, and he was so excited to get some hallacas, he ran back. And so I went around and I was just asking them to think about it. How many of you are from a different country? How many of you can get your country's food immediately and ready? Is it easy to get your country's food? Can you find Russian food everywhere? No? So to have your country's cuisine cooked the way it's supposed to makes a big difference. And so we had many volunteers. And it's interesting, then we went over downtown, there's a Walmart, and there are a lot of Venezuelanos, I think it was Venezuelans, and Venezuelan, my Spanish is getting better and better, but just not today, okay? And so one of the things that God tells us, that when we serve people, then they're much more likely to listen to what we have to say about the gospel. This is what we call evangeliving. And so we went out and we served. These are some of the volunteers. And so, you know, when God says, I will honor those who honor me, I want you to watch this video and see what God is doing.
Diego, pues hoy desafortunadamente duerme en las calles, parte de un problema por falta de vivienda, pero también de la desorientación y de la falta de información de esta comunidad. Hoy nos dicen que no hay espacio en dichos albergues. Marínez Zavala nos amplía.
Desde este edificio en la Junta de Supervisores de San Diego se han emitido declaratorias de emergencia, se han destinado millones de dólares. A la comunidad migrante. Sin embargo, la realidad es que se espera que muchos de estos pasen las fiestas durmiendo en las calles de San Diego.
Tengo mi mochila y un suéter solamente. Así como usted me ve, así estoy.
Freddy es uno de los migrantes que lleva por lo menos 2 días durmiendo en las calles de San Diego. Dijo a pesar de los riesgos que vivió en su país. Estar sin hogar en Estados Unidos también da miedo.
Te da miedo, no se sabe si uno está durmiendo y venga un muchacho de eso y le vaya a hacer algo a uno dormido, o sea, son cosas de esperarse también porque estamos en la calle.
A días de las fiestas, las iglesias y activistas dicen ver este problema crecer y les preocupa la cercanía de los migrantes en las calles con quienes sufren problemas de adicciones.
Donde los que vienen de afuera sin este tipo de problemas de adicciones corren el riesgo de caer en adicciones también. Y es un problema que verdaderamente sería de magnitudes que no nos podemos imaginar.
Hoy al traerles grandes ollas con sopa a los migrantes que viven en las calles, aseguran toda la comida se acaba.
Proveerles una sopa caliente para que ellos puedan salir adelante, especialmente en este tiempo de invierno, de frío, donde muchos tienen enfermedades, su sistema inmune está bajo.
Por su parte, José Ángel, quien ha pasado ya 40 días en Estados Unidos, está días de que se le vence el albergue en San Diego que hasta hoy le ha dado una cama.
Allá me faltan 5 días. De ahí tengo que buscar la manera de cómo solucionar para que me extiendan, si me van a extender.
El temor a regresar a dormir en las calles, asegura, es una constante.
En una banqueta y con el abrigo, pero conchale, me sentía mal, ¿sí me entiendes?
Y aún en la espera del milagro de Navidad, aseguran dormir en las calles de San Diego es mejor que las de Chicago o estados donde hace frío e incluso cae nieve.
Me toca dormir sentado, a veces me acuesto, me pongo la cabeza en el bolso. Y así, esperanzado que Dios es grande, pues, él sabe qué propósito tiene para cada quien.
Y mientras muchos de estos migrantes nos dijeron, siguen en las listas de espera, esperando si habrá algún espacio en algún albergue del condado de San Diego, también nos dicen que tienen mucha esperanza de que algo cambie y puedan encontrar no solo un techo, sino también un trabajo aquí en Estados Unidos. Son los detalles desde San Diego. Marínez Zavala, Telemundo 20.
Okay, and the people said?
Amen.
So, God says, I will honor those who honor me. I believe moving into 2024, people need action. We've been talking about it all year long. But when we actually have the heart of God, it will move us to action. Now, everybody cannot do everything, but everybody can do something. Amen? And so, if you want to help what we're doing in the streets, there are many, many ways. We're actually trying to house as many of these families as possible. The system for shelters is overrun. There's too many people and not enough room. Especially if you have a family, there's places for women with children, there are places for men, but there are very few places for families. And so here we set up a GoFundMe, and all this money goes strictly to helping the people that need the help. Also, as you know, we have partnered with SALT. So SALT has now set up SALT San Diego. It's sandiegosalt.org, and you can now go there, and you'll see that you can also become a sponsor. So if somebody you know wants to donate, maybe they don't want to do the GoFundMe, maybe they don't want to give it to the church, but they can give it to SALT. Also, they can give through our ministry, 10talents.org. You can go and designate it there for SALT. Also, starting in January, we want to officially launch as SALT And so there's on the website, you can go there and you can sign up to be a volunteer every Sabbath afternoon from 3:30. There's also a waiver that you must sign. So just in case, God forbid, something happens to you, you won't try to sue us or sue Salt, right? And so there's a waiver that everybody will sign. Also, these are the times and the schedules and the places, and these are the things that we need that we will be doing. We're starting with food, but I just want to encourage us. I hope that this encourages you, because guess what? When we're not just sharing soup. I don't know, for those who didn't understand the Spanish, they said that, you know what? I feel esperanza. I have hope now. And so think about it. You're living on the streets in San Diego, and guess what? Now people are coming, and they're not only giving you food, but they're giving you hope, right? And so this afternoon, we're going to go out again, and I went through my closet. I don't know about you, but I went to my closet, and I'm a shoe fanatic, and I had all these shoes, and I said, how many feet do I have? I only have 2 feet, so guess what? I had all these shoes, so our family filled up a bag full of shoes, because the last time we went out to give clothes, the men were like, do you have shoes? Now, women, more women get clothing easier, but men tend to hold on to their clothes just a little bit longer. And so if you're a man and you have some pants or a jeans or a sweater or something that you're not using, you haven't worn it in a couple months, it means, you know, some of us have storages, right? If you have things, please donate them so that we can go and give it to people in need. You know, I got a call from somebody who's homeless, and they called me, and this is the second time in the last 2 weeks. They said, Pastor Lee, I want to go to sleep, and I never want to wake up. And they literally, for the 5 minutes, they screamed at me and said, Pastor Lee, I need help. I don't need your prayers. I need something tangible and something real. This is the second time this person called me. The last time they called me, it was 4 a.m. and I showed up, and they were like, I want to kill somebody. And then last week, actually the week before last, I met a gentleman, and he said the same thing. He says, I'm tired of living on the streets. I want to go to sleep, and I never want to wake up again. And so this is what I do when I meet somebody in that condition. I say, give me 5 things that you're thankful for. And they were like, what? 5 things that I'm thankful for? I was like, just give me 5 things you're thankful for. Well, I'm alive. Okay, 4. And they go, 3, 2, 1. And by the time I said, look at you, you have at least 5 things to live for. Right? But guess what? I didn't say, well, bless you, brother. I hope that you figure it out. I had just gotten back, and I had a $300 gift card, and I went to Walmart, and I spent the money that was given to me, and I bought him a tent, and I brought him a sleeping pad. And he didn't even know how to put the tent up. He was like, I don't even know how to, and so I helped him put up the tent. And then at 5 o'clock, I showed up the next day, and I woke him up, and I said, hey, let me show you how to take the tent down. Let's pack it up. And then I took him to the local drop-in center, and the man who introduced me to him was there that next morning. He showed up last Sabbath. He says, I'm not a religious person, but I want to know the church you belong to. He didn't care if it was Catholic. He didn't care if it was Baptist or Buddhist. He didn't care. He said, I want to know your God. Because your God is real. Is he? We used to sing this song, I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. We sing the song, he's able, he's able, he's able. How will they know? Go to Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. How will they know? Romans chapter 10. Starting with verse 13. If you have it, please say amen. It says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord," what? Now notice, God says, the Bible says, that whosoever, that's the same whosoever in John 3:16 that says, whosoever what? Believes in him shall not perish, but have what? So it's the same whosoever, right? So now he says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord, what? So according to this, how is one saved? By calling on the name of Jesus. Now that might be oversimplified for some of us, but it's scripture, amen? Now, notice how the Bible continues to say in verse 14, how then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in whom they have not? And how shall they hear without a? Now, that word preacher is a witness. So we think of preachers as people like me who stand up here and do this thing. But the Bible says, you are my witnesses, saith the Lord, that I am God. So they need to call on the name of Jesus, but he's saying, how can they call on him? How can they believe on him? How can they do this if no one tells them, better yet, shows them the love of Jesus? Verse 15, and how shall they preach except they be sent? For it is written, how beautiful are the mouths of them that... Oh, it doesn't say mouth, does it? It says, how beautiful are the feet that what? So how do we preach the gospel? With our feet. Is that what the Bible says? So we don't preach the gospel with what we say. We preach the gospel with what we... He says, how beautiful, this is God now, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the what? And bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel, says Isaiah. Lord, who has believed our report? So then, faith comes by what? And hearing by the? But I say, have they not heard? So now, he turns from the they out there, and now he begins to talk about the they in here. He says, have they not heard about what I've asked them to do? Have they not seen what I'm willing to do for them? How long? Notice what Isaiah 58 says. Let's go to Isaiah 58. Isaiah 58. Isaiah 58. All year, I've been praying, Lord, give me a shepherd's heart. What have I been praying for? Because I naturally, I don't know about you, I naturally, my natural self is not sympathetic, is not empathetic. It doesn't naturally open up. You might be like me. You've been hurt. You've been disappointed. You've been misused and abused, and you're broken. And so you have a defense mechanism. We all have them, don't we? So I've been praying, Lord, it's really easy to preach the sermons. You've gifted me to be able to communicate your word, but the hardest thing is after the sermon. That's the hardest thing after church. It's after potluck. It's on the way home. It's on Sunday and Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday. Oh, the Sabbath is coming Friday. Let's pray. Let's get our house in order. Oh, Sabbath is here. Happy Sabbath, everyone. That's easy to show up on Sabbath or prayer meeting, or that's the easiest thing to do. But when people are in their mess, literally and figuratively, when people are broken, and you have to inconvenience yourself to accommodate their mess. Because guess what? We always look at them, and do we all have a mess? We think it's their problem, but guess what? My mess is more is way worse than theirs. But guess what? I can dress it up a little bit better, right? Put on the suit, put on the tie, put on the smile. So how do we reach the world with the everlasting gospel? That's the question. So notice what Isaiah 58 tells us. This is the inconvenient truth about giving the gospel. It says, Isaiah 58, starting with verse 6, is not this the fast that I have chosen? So if you read verses 1 through 5, the children of Israel are complaining to God. They're talking about how they've been fasting and they've been praying and they've been seeking God, and God has not heard their prayers. And God says, when you fast for strife and debate. When you fast, it's a selfish, sinful, unrighteous fast. He's like, let me show you the true fast. He says, is not this the fast that I have chosen? So who's speaking? God is saying, this is what I have chosen for you to do. Notice it says, to loose the bands of, to undo the heavy, and to let the oppressed go, and that you break every, wait. So notice, the fast, the religion of the Bible is an action. It's an active process. It's actually going out to the wicked and helping them. Those who are heavy laden with burdens, when they call you at inconvenient times, getting up out of your bed and going there and say, I can't help you, I'm just going to be here. Notice what else it says. Verse 7, is it not to deal your bread to the what? That you bring the poor that are cast out into the streets, where? Wait. What did it say? How many of you live in a house more than 2,500 square feet? Don't raise your hand. How many of you live in a house bigger than 980 square feet? How many of you have extra rooms in your house that you don't even use? You have closets and you have garages and you have, like, God is saying, hey, I gave you all this space. Not for you. I blessed you with finances, but the finances are not for you. How shall they know about me without you? So I need you to get out of your religiosity. Get up and go out, and guess what? He says, they will see your good works. And they will glorify your Father, which is in heaven. This is true Christianity. This is the gospel in action. This is what's going to bring persecution. Did you know that? This is what's going to bring hatred. This is what, so because I have somebody who lives close to me. Anyways, I had another Christian of another denomination and affiliation. And they said, man, you're making me look bad. I said, what? Man, like, I see what you guys are doing, and you're making me look bad. I said, brother, sister, you can do it too. Come and join the Christian army. I know you can't do everything, but everybody can do what? Something. That's what God is saying in 2024. Will my people do something, anything, please? He says, verse 7, is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry and to that bring the poor that are cast out to your house? When you see the naked, you know, some people come to this country and they only have the clothes on their back and a little backpack. So he says, it's our responsibility to do what? To clothe the naked and to cover him, that thou hidest not your face from your own. So what is God saying? You can answer. What is God saying? Are they not humans? Right? Different language, different culture, but are they created in the image of God? He said, how shall they know me if you don't show them my character? Now notice the result. When the church, the body of Christ on planet Earth, comes together in service, what will happen? What will be the result of this one accord? What will be the result? Notice what it says in verse 8. He says, then, what? Wait. Then your light will what? As the morning, and your health shall spring forth speedily, and your righteousness. Wait. Your what? Your righteousness shall go. Wow. So God says, verses 6 to 7. When this becomes a reality in the church, the result of that will be the world will see the light of Jesus. He says, then your light shall come, right? He says, it shall go forth before thee. The glory of the Lord shall be your reward. He says, then shalt thou call, and I shall. By the way, how many of you guys have had unanswered prayers? You've been praying, and guess what? God is saying, you need to look at what I have said. Have I not commanded you? And you're praying, you're crying out, and guess what? Nada. Nothing. And God is saying, I need you. I need you. You are the only you God has. Your skills, your gifts, your talents, your personality. So I'm going to tell the story about this week. I went and played basketball this week. And me and Brother Shook have been playing for, what, 5-6 months now? And I went and he wasn't there. And I was playing and I hadn't played in about 3 weeks. And so I'm there for exercise. I'm trying to keep my weight down, you know, all this, you know, San Diego, right? And I was just throwing up brick after brick after brick after brick. And for some reason, I kept shooting. I don't understand why. But and so one of the people got upset with me and used some very colorful words and told me to get off the court, right? Because we were losing, right? Now, I'm trying to evangelize. I'm trying to be a witness. They all know, I think they know I'm a pastor, right? Right? I've invited them to the cooking classes and I'm there for exercise, but guess what? Something rose up in me. I think it was pride. And I said, you know what? Go sit down. I'm going to go sit down. I went and sat down, and I started taking off my shoes. And they were like, hey, we need 10. And I was the 10th person. And I was like, oh, I'm good. You guys don't want me to play? I'm good. And they were like, oh, man, you know. And then one guy, he came over. He's like, hey, man, come on and play. Now, that was a challenge, y'all. And I was thinking afterwards, like, did I represent Jesus in that moment? Is pouting? Maybe I was pouting, sulking, my pride was hurt. Could I invite them to church after that interaction? Ah. Because they expect more from us, that's why. Don't they? Should they not expect more from someone who's walking with Jesus? And so the next day I went to another gym and I met somebody else, one of Jonathan's friends. And he was like, why are you here? Nobody's playing. I was like, man, I got to work on my shot. Because I can't go back over there. You know, I can't be a sorry player and try to witness, right? Doesn't the world honors excellence? The only reason why I'm playing basketball is because I want to witness. Evangelizing. He says in verse 9, then shalt thou call, and the Lord shall answer. Thou shalt cry, and he shall say, here am I. If you will take away what? From the midst of you, what? The yoke. What did Jesus say? We started, Jesus says, my yoke is, my burden is. So there's a yoke that Jesus offers us, but then there's another yoke. What is that other yoke? What do you think it is? He says, take away the yoke, the putting forth of the, and the speaking vanity. So what do you think that, interpolate that for me, somebody. What is the yoke that God says needs to be put away in order for his presence and power and glory to be manifested? What is it? It's pride, it's self. Right? So when the church comes to God and says, Lord, take my heart, for I cannot give it. Lord, please give me a heart of flesh. Lord, do a new thing in me. Then people will know. It says in verse 10, and if you will draw out your soul to the hungry, and satisfy the afflicted soul, then shall your light rise in obscurity, and your darkness shall be as noonday. And the Lord shall what? How long? And satisfy your soul in the drought, and make fat your bones, and you shall be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters what? Would you like to be a wellspring that never fails? Isn't that what Jesus told the woman at the well? He says, I have living water. The Bible says in Jeremiah, he says, that my people have committed two sins. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living water, and they have dug for themselves. They have created themselves broken cisterns that hold no water. It says in Isaiah that He says, I will bring forth springs in the desert. You know that scripture? He says, this church, your life will become an oasis for those who are hungering and thirsting for Jesus. They don't even know it. So this week, I was challenged, like to my core. It wasn't the basketball thing. Something happened, and I was confronted with the reality to be like Jesus or to be like religious folks, churchgoers. My family and I, we cried tears. But I can tell you, God prevailed. My brothers and my sisters, verse 12 says, and they that shall be of thee shall build the old waste places. Thou shalt raise up the foundations of many generations, and thou shalt be called the repairers of the breach, the restorers of the past to dwell in. If you turn away your foot from the Sabbath, from doing your pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy of the Lord, honorable, and shall honor him, not doing your own ways, nor finding your own pleasure, nor speaking your own words. So what is the Sabbath really about then? It's about service. What has Sabbath become to Sabbatarians? Sleep. Rest. Relaxation. You know why? Because we've been running on the hamster wheel of Babylon all week. And by the time we come to church, we're too exhausted to give God what is his. And so God's call is to come out of her, my people. Isn't that what it says? Come out of her. He says, my yoke is easy. And my burden, guess what? Babylon's yoke is galling. When they say come, what do? Right? If your boss calls you and say, hey, I need you at such and such a time, at such and such a place, and we have an emergency meeting, and oh, I know. Right? And if you don't show up with bells on, ready to, your whole livelihood is in what? Is in jeopardy. God is saying, I have a system that's better than that. I have a system that will sustain you from now until eternity, but I need you to exercise faith. I don't know what that looks like for you. I don't know where you're at. I don't know what you're struggling with. I don't know. But God knows you needed to hear this today. Because guess what? This was not the sermon, by the way. This was not the sermon. If I go through, look, this was the sermon today. But God said, no, that they need a word from me. So I don't know what your conviction is, but I'm going to roll with Joshua. He said, as for me and my house, I don't know about you and your house, but as me and my house, because that's only, I'm only responsible for what? My house. This is his house. You're his children, right? So as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Father in heaven, Lord, I want to say thank you for answering my prayer, Lord. That, Lord, you are in the process of giving me a new heart. Lord, you're in the process of giving me a new spirit. And Lord, I am not special. I am the least, but Lord, you said you'll take the foolish things to confound the wise. Lord, my brothers and my sisters here, Lord, we are rich and increased with goods. We are not in need of anything, Father. But yet, the Bible says Jesus stands at the door of the heart and minds of his people, saying, yes, you have all that you think you need, but the most essential thing is me, and I stand outside of your life. I stand adjacent to your job and your the things that you love. You are distracted, and you're calling us, Father. You're calling us. Lord, I pray today that we would hear your voice. And that, Lord, it wouldn't be another voice, but Lord, we would respond to that still small voice that says, London, put your name there. This is the way. Walk ye in it. My Father, I pray that, Lord, you would do a new thing for us here, Lord. The topic was today talking about being rooted and grounded in love. Lord, you said love does not think of herself. Love looks on others. Love is other-centered. Oh, Father, we have not this love. But Lord, this is the love that the world is waiting to experience. So Lord, please, Lord, we're crying out. Please. Give us that which you long to give us so that we can become preachers, teachers, and we can truly understand what it means to evangelize. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Our closing hymn is hymn number 435.
Let's stand up for singing the closing hymn, which is Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior.
Thank you.
never should the word of God be presented without a decision. I don't know what you heard, but I pray that you would respond to whatever God said to you today. The call is a call to action. And so if you want to respond to God's call on your life, I invite you to come forward. You might not know what that looks like. You want to say, Lord, I want to be your hands. I want to be your feet. I want to be your instrument. I don't know what that looks like. I don't know how that's going to inconvenience me. I don't know what sacrifices I will have to make. And for those of you who are not responding physically, if not now, then when? If we truly believe that Jesus is coming, if not now, then you can respond in many different ways. You don't have to physically. You can just say, Lord, you know my heart. But this final call that we find in Revelation 18 is a call to action. And I believe that God is going to blow our minds in 2024. But we need all hands on deck. The battle is not ours. It's what? It's the Lord's. I'm going to reiterate, could you go back to my PowerPoint? I was impressed by God that 2024 was going to be a challenging year on planet Earth. And so God had me put this media detox challenge in. And if you go back to the sanctuary, remember that they were supposed to give their first fruits to who?
To the Lord.
To the Lord, right? And so the first fruits of the year would be the first 7 days.
Amen.
And you want to say, Lord, I'm going to detoxify not only my body, but I need to detox my mind. And so I'm going to accept the challenge. For the first 7 days, you can sign up. It's 100% free. I'm going to launch a video every single morning, and we're going to have a live presentation, a recap on YouTube. So if you're watching at home, if you know somebody who... And some people say, well, Pastor, I work on media. This is talking about entertainment. This is talking about what you do with your free time, you know, when you're scrolling or when you're watching. And some older people say, well, I'm not on social media. Well, whatever you occupy your time with, it can be for that too. And so God is challenging us that we need to go into this year differently. So I want to challenge you to detoxify. I'll also be going live on Instagram for those of you who are Instagram. And sorry for those who speak Spanish. Yo no hablo mucho español. Lo siento. But next year, I'm studying Spanish. That's one of my convictions. I gotta study Spanish. And so next year, when we do this again, I wanna do one in Spanish. Amen? Let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, this has been an awesome year, Lord. But Lord, you said greater things than this you will see. Lord, you said eye has not seen, ear has not heard, it hasn't even entered into the minds of men and women, boys and girls, what you have planned for those who love you. And Lord, I know and believe that every single person in here, in their innermost being, they long for you, Father. And the things of this world are just temporary, Father, but you are eternal. And you are calling us into an intimate and deep and personal relationship. Lord, it's going to take us places that we never thought we would be. But Lord, you're developing your character in us. Oh, Father, let us not resist your work in us, through us, and in spite of us. Father, as we go into this new year, I know the world is going to go and party and drink, but Lord, may we be found praying and seeking you, Father, that, Lord, we may enter into 2024 abiding, rooted, and grounded in the love of God. And that, Lord, when we convene here next Sabbath, that, Lord, we will not be the same. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to invite you today, 3:30. What time?
30.
What time?
3:30.
We will be at Father Joe's. We have bags of clothes to give away. So if you want to assist, please. At the 2 o'clock hour, we're not going to have Evangel Living. We're going to have a short prayer session, and we're going to organize so when we go down there, everybody will be organized. Amen? God bless you.
Assist you exiting the sanctuary, we invite all of you to stay for a plant-based luncheon here in our fellowship hall. We have a special line for guests who will be served first. God bless you all.